Joining me on the sofa today is Robert Erskine Johnson and Preston Glass in part two of the tribute to the late Thom Bell.
You're in there with the cream of the crop.
Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are on the globe. Welcome to On the Sofa with Esther. And in this particular section, I'm going to be paying tribute once again to the late, great Thom Bell, who we lost on December the 22nd, 2022. And I thought it would be good to reach out to people around me who wanted to pay tribute to this man. And I remember interviewing John Wilson from Sly, Slick and Wicked. And he said, you know, he goes, a lot of people don't get their flowers. And so I want to be in a position to give them their flowers by talking to people who worked with them, who knew them, and who want something to say something about this incredible genius. So welcome, Robert and Johnson.
My pleasure to be here. You know, I never actually worked with Thom. We were friends, you know, as a matter of fact, Thom and Leon Huff, Kenny Gamble, you know, they're all my friends, and they created a company called the Mighty Three Music Company.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was called the Mighty Three Music, group. They called the Mighty Three Music Group, you know, and Thom and Kenny would always tell me that, you know, you'll never forget our tunes. And they had an elephant, you know, a three-headed elephant is their logo and symbol.
Excellent.
And in the first time me and Thom actually, Thom was born in Kingston, Jamaica.
Yes, he was, yes.
Yeah, and by the time we first actually became pretty good friends, I was like a model at the time, you know, 51 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and I remember he got me a photographer by the name of Michael Denny. And he also, if you see any old pictures of Thom Bell, you know, he's the one that took those pictures too.
Oh, wow.
And so anyway, he took my pictures and, you know, I did a lot of, different films and stuff that, you know, he was my photographer.
Mm-hmm.
And Thom, you know, him and Pooji Hart from the Delphonics, you know, they started writing songs together. I believe La 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 means I love you may have been one of them. And they were publishing eventually. I forget which publishing company they used, because I mean, Thom was with Gamble and Huff with Mighty Three Music. Mm-hmm. And I forget which one Pooji had, but I know Warner Chappell, you know, was one of the head publishing companies for it. But Thom influenced a lot of outside individuals to become great writers. One of my best friends by the name of Phil Hurt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the churches I was a member of, Parkside Methodist Church in Parkside section of Camden, New Jersey. Phil Hertz, the music director, and him and Thom wrote songs together. Matter of fact, one of them they wrote together was I'll Be Around by the Spinners.
Oh, by the Spinners, yes.
Yeah, they wrote that. And then Linda Creed, you know, she was from Germantown in Philadelphia. And so somewhere along the line, Thom wound up bringing her over to Philly International Records with 309 Broad Street in Philadelphia. It was the address, you know, where Kenny Gamble, Leon Huff, and Thom Bell, they had, the Mighty Three Music had great, great writers. Mm-hmm. I mean, not just Thom Bell and Kenny Gamble, Leon Huff, but they also employed guys like Phil Hurt, Bunny Sigler, you know, Douglas City Brown, who I later produced him myself.
Mm.
Dexter Wansell, you know, then they had great singers, Billy Paul, you know, he was my neighbor. And when Thom brought Linda Creed on board, mm-hmm. she started writing with him. You know, they did a phenomenal
Fantastic.
Job.
Yes. Right?
They wrote like Bet You By Golly Wow, you know, Stone in Love With You, and So many songs that they wrote. And, you know, before, you know, Thom got sick or passed, you know, a couple fellas that I know in the film industry, you know, one of them told me he was actually, you know, you know, going to be maybe executive producer with him on a major movie. This was about 3 years ago, so it never came about, you know. But you know, I know some, Archie Bell and the Drells. He wrote for them. He did. Matter of fact, when he got his Grammy, I think it was in 1974, for Producer of the Year. And then Dionne Warwick contacted him and asked would he do something for her. And I forget the name of the song and album that they did, but then they worked together. You know, he worked with Johnny Mathis, well, naturally, all the Philadelphia International Record crew, Billy Paul, Lou Rawls, you know.
Some of the greats, isn't it? The greats, yeah. And you know, Robert, for you, I mean, this is such incredible. You know, every time I talk to someone, I'm getting that so much more about this band. You know, there was so much to him. And for you, Robert, what was the essence that he carried that was so unique? Because in a previous interview, like I said, that I did 2 weeks ago, they said he was a genius, he was unique. To you, what was that unique?
You know, with the man, he was like Sly and the Family Stones, everyday people, but he knew how to write songs. Matter of fact, he, you know, I don't know if I'm getting off the subject or not, but, you know, Cameo Records was a record label that was in Philadelphia. Yes. I don't know if anybody mentioned that to you or not, but he was writing with them and Leon Huff, Kenny Gamble, and you know, they had a little group, you know, that they had with Cameo. And I think that might have been the first record company that he may have wrote for. Another one, I think, was called Avco or something. But, you know, I know he wrote for that. But, you know, he was like a I don't know if I want to call it natural poet, because Kenny Gamble was too. So I don't want to say one was more natural than the other one. But, I mean, I believe that, you know, I personally, as a God-believing guy, and I believe that, you know, God's spirit gave him the knowledge to write these things that he wrote.
Absolutely.
And then for him to even look out and say, oh yeah, this guy, because when he said Sidney Brown could write good, you know, I didn't even know Sidney could write, you know, Tom saying he could. So, you know, I don't even know if Tom had even heard it, write or seen anything he wrote. But I believe that his spirit told him that this guy, you know, is good, and he became a great writer with them. You know? So I believe that, you know, God's spirit also made him, you know, the way he is. That's why, you know, when I would think about God myself, you know, and I know everybody probably don't think about God the way I do, but, you know, I believe this, and I don't know if you ever, you know, and, you know, I might say this kind of humorous, but there was a DJ in Philadelphia named Butterball, and he passed away. And so, you know, I made a statement. I said, well, you know, God is calling all the great ones. Now he needed a writer, so he called Tom. So, I mean, you know, I believe that truly believe as a God-fearing man as he was, that, you know, he was a natural. And just like a person, those that, you know, penned the Bible, if you listen to the lyrics to some of the songs that he wrote, you'll get the message. Even Kenny Gamble would say there's a message in his music.
Absolutely, you know?
And it really is, you know, whether it was a love song or whether it was a song about something else, you know. So, I mean, and plus, I don't know of not one person on earth that could say anything bad about him.
Yes, and that's what I'm realizing, you know, there's so many people that are coming forward and say, oh, I knew someone who worked with him, I knew someone who was mentored, and it's all good, it's all positive. And I guess also, you know, that's the great thing about, you know, when we're left behind, so to speak, we have to continue the legacy. We have to continue the legacy of being a certain type of person that people can look up to, that people can, other than being a producer, singer, songwriter, he was a multi-instrumentalist as well. There was so much to him, and he gave. And what was really interesting is that he also, I feel, he had this gift or talent to see into others and to pull out the best. I mean, he took some of those songs and what he, you know, how he turned them around. You know, there's a real sort of gift in that.
Yeah, absolutely. He was called to do what he did. He wasn't called to do anything else, and he did it to the fullest. He made his mark, he did it naturally without any stress, at least I'd never seen no stress, right?
You go. That's the thing. And Robert, it'd be nice to get to know a little bit about you as well, because you were Thom Bell's friend. But it would be nice to know who Thom Bell's friend is, if you don't mind me just telling him down.
Oh no, I don't mind telling you. My name is Robert Erskine Johnson, which you know, mm-hmm. and I am currently the owner of the former Motown Soul Records label.
Soul Records.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which at one time. Had Gladys Knight. Did I heard it through the grapevine on Soul Records?
Yeah.
Jimmy Ruffin, what becomes of the Broken Hearted, that was recorded on Soul Records. Shotgun, by Junior Walking All Stars. And I may even redo What Does It Take to Win Your Love for Me again on there with a band, where one of the bands called Exclusive Soul, but one of the artists I have now is Frank Green. So we may redo it. I have current office artists on there, like Lady Jules. She has a record called If You're Tired of Me Until That mm-hmm. Moment. Bobby Eli, who used to work with Tom too, he worked with the Sound of Philadelphia. He wrote like Love Won't Let Me Wait. That was one of his songs.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And him and Ricky Starr wrote If You're Tired of Me. And Lady Joel, she's a Russian descent. She sings like 5 different languages and, very well. And we're working on a couple of songs for her right now. One of them is one that I just finished that I wrote. It's called Tell Me How Long the Train's Been Gone. And we just finished that. We got a couple more we're working on. I have another artist by the name of Ralph Dudley. He's in Los Angeles. Mm. He has one called Soul Latino. And the record Soul Latino is also in a TV series that I'm one of the producers of, and I play a judge called Chase Street. And Chase Street is a political crime television series that's based out of Camden, New Jersey. Clifton Powell is one of the major stars in it. Vinny Pastore from Sopranos. We got quite Terrell Hicks from Bronx Tales is in it.
Ooh, your name is names, Robert.
Yeah. But all the attorneys are actual attorneys that are friends of mine. And I played one of the judges, and it's based on real stuff. And, currently, I'm doing a couple other films. One of them is Deadwood, which is another Western. Mm. One of them is Black Caesar, which is a true American gangster story. And the other one is Cotton Club of Harlem. And, I'm in communication with the actual owner now of the Cotton Club. So I'll probably be doing some scenes or films from there as well. And also, we're going to do a documentary on Soul Records as well, too.
Good. And that's probably why it's been so, it's taken a while to tie you down to do this interview, because you were so incredibly busy. But also, in winding down, I think there's something really important also that people need to know about you, because you're doing all this and you have Soul Records. But it's, you are very much about diversity and inclusivity within the industry. That's an important part that you left out, Robert. So just tell us why you are championing, exclusivity and diversity within the industry. What's so important?
And that's strange that you asked me that, because I never had an interview with you before. Unless you read something, because I always emphasize that, mm-hmm. About the diversity. I have Hispanic artists, Russian artists, Japanese artists, of course, I got African-American artists.
Absolutely.
I got every nationality. I got one of my producers right now, he's working on some music, we got one person from France. As a matter of fact, one of my friends, who was actually from New Jersey, that's a lawyer in France, they had directed them in my direction. And one of the other ones, she's French too, but she's more Haitian.
Mm.
But yeah, I think the spirit got me to do this, because when Berry Gordy first started Soul Records as part of Motown, he had great artists. He had like Earl Van Dyke and the Motown Brass that became mm-hmm. the Funk Brothers that backed up all the artists on Motown. They recorded on Soul Records. Shorty Long, Here Come the Judge was a popular song that was on Soul Records. So After I was able to obtain it, you know, I realized soul, there's nothing more mentioned in the world other than God, other than soul. Yeah. And, you know, and I commend you as far as soul TV, mm-hmm. you know, because the word soul carries so much momentum.
Absolutely. And, yes.
Yeah. And at the time, you know, I was able to either the Soul Records, Chess Records, because David Geffen wound up with Chess Records, Stax Records, which Isaac Hayes and them were on. Mm-hmm. But Soul Records was like, not only did it resonate with me, but as a kid, when I was like 14 years old, I mean, I played those Soul Records artists. I mean, it was part of Motown, but I heard it through the grapevine. Was on Soul Records. You know, Shotgun was on Soul Records. Marvin Gaye wrote Baby, I'm For Real, him and his wife, Anna Gordy. They wrote Baby, I'm For Real, and the original was recorded. That was on Soul Records. And one of them that I could sing when I was a kid, I'd never hear the bells if you leave me, right? You know, and Marvin wrote that, but it was on Soul Records. So, you know, so the spirit of me that somehow had something to do with Soul Records had already been instilled upon me when I was a teenager,
mm.
you know? And so when I had the opportunity to get it, you know, I previously had a label called Mac Dad Records.
That, yes.
Yeah. And me and my brother Fred were partners in that. But Soul was a calling, you know, by God to make sure that I get it and resurrect it and keep mm. it alive and well with new artists and make it as diversity as all the people in the world. We bleed the same blood. So, you know.
Love that. And, you know, there is something about soul, because soul is something that's deep, that's rich, that's overflowing. Soul, you know, you got soul food, soul love, all of that.
Exactly.
And so it's nice that you've expanded that into to reach out into that inclusive, diverse world, just bringing everybody together, because, you know, yeah, it's about the soul of everything as well. So we're not going to go too deep because I know time is limited, but, you know, this has been a wonderful interview. I mean, I love the knowledge of what you have about your industry, but also your passion for what you do, Robert. And, you know, in winding down, is there anything else that you would like to share about your friendship, about Thom Bell, or just about Thom Bell as the man he was?
Well, he's a great brother. I can't say nothing bad about him. I'm definitely positive that he's in heaven. You know, and hello, Tom, you know, love you. And I can't say no more. You know, when I say a person's definitely in heaven, that means God loves them just like I would have loved them.
Oh, wow. Fantastic. Robert, I'd just like to say a huge thank you for your time. Huge thank you for your contribution and your tribute. I also like to say a big thank you to Carrie Brown for putting us together and making this happen. Okay. Thank you very much and wishing you all the best.
I thank you so much for having me. Wonderful.
A real pleasure. All right. And I love thank your laughter. You. It's just so exuberant. Wow. It's just like bam, bam, bam. Fantastic.
Well, thank you.
All right.
Bye bye.
Bye. Book your exclusive experience today with Tony Jazz, bespoke lifestyle manager to the rich and famous, professional butler and fine dining restaurant reviewer, the butlers of Mayfair Bespoke Events. Your wish is our command. Right, so good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are across the globe. Welcome to On the Sofa with yours truly, Esther Austin. Well, as you know, I've been doing some shows around paying tribute to the late Thom Bell, who passed away on December the 22nd, 2022. And it's been interesting because people are just coming forward who want to share their experience of Thom Bell and what he meant to them. And when I look at his portfolio, you know, not only is he huge as a songwriter, a singer, a producer, an arranger, he was a multi-talented instrumentalist, but just because of who he was as a person. And so today joining me, I have Preston Glass, who in himself, this gentleman, has quite an expansive career as well. He's a singer, a songwriter, and a producer. So we're going to dive a bit more into this gentleman's history. But welcome, Preston.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it, Esther, for having me on.
No, thank you. Thank you. Now, as I said, you've got quite an illustrious career as it is. I love that word. It's quite tongued with an illustrious career yourself. You know, looking at your profile, Thom Bell was your mentor. He was also your friend. But then even in terms of the work that you have done, produced, worked on, you know, composed with others. So to move the conversation forward, in a nutshell, in a peanut shell or a crab shell, who is Preston Glass?
Well, I'm a songwriter, but, you know, especially as it relates to today's interview, I'm a direct product of Thom Bell. I mean, he signed me when I was 17 years old, fresh out of high school. He signed me and my brother, Alan Glass, who, by the way, is living in London now.
Okay.
Yeah, I met Thom when I was 15, and I still live in California, and I lived in California at the time. I was a junior in high school, a sophomore in high school, when I flew 3,000 miles to see this gentleman who was giving a seminar in Philadelphia. And I grew up on his music, staring at the little records and noticing his name next to Linda Creed or so I just knew, oh, I want to work with this guy. I want to learn from him. I want to be a songwriter. I don't want to be an artist. I want to be like Thom Bell. So I never knew I would ever work with him, but I knew I would like to meet him at the very least. And so that's what prompted me to fly 3,000 miles to meet him. And basically I went to the seminar, and I guess he was impressed with my persistence and me flying, you know, at such a young age that far to see him. He said, well, when you finish high school, look me up.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, I'd like to move to Philadelphia and finish high school here and work under you.
Wow.
And he whispered in my ear and said, don't tell nobody, but I'm actually moving out to the West Coast, which is what he did. He moved to Seattle. And so I looked him up like he asked me to, and the rest is history. That he liked our music enough to sign me as a staff writer. I was 19 at the time. In fact, I was the last, me and my brother were the last two songwriters Thom Bell ever signed to his publishing company, Bell Boy Music, which was under the Mighty Three, with Gamble, Huff, and Bell.
Yeah. Well, you know, your persistence really paid off. And what's coming to me, Preston, is what was it about Thom Bell that made him so special and unique? Because I've interviewed others and they talk about him being a genius and all, you know, using all those wonderful descriptive words. But for you, what was the uniqueness about Thom Bell that made him such a great man? And also at what he did, because he seemed to have had this unique way of recognizing talent and drawing that in.
That's a good point. Yeah, and that is a very good word, unique, because not only, of course, his God-given genius and his talent, but he was a man of his own direction. In other words, sure, he worked with Gamble, Huff, but you notice he didn't go with Philly International Records as a partner. He stayed independent because he was a man of his own terms. He did, you know, independent productions while still working with Gamble, Huff. You know, record companies would want him to do this, do that. He did his own thing. And so I think because he knew that he was different, he knew that. And, you know, I'm not going to say that when I was 15 or 17 or 19, when I signed with him, that I knew this about him. But after working with him and then getting to know him, getting to be his friend, and I really got to know that about him, that he really was, he was a private individual. In fact, I remember one time telling somebody that I worked with Thom Bell. This was early in my career. They said, you actually worked with him? How did you get to do that? He's harder to get to than the Pope. That's what they said. I said, you know, and then, you know, I didn't realize that at the time. I just knew I loved his music and just pursued that. I realized later what a privilege it was to get accepted into that circle. And like I said, to be the last writer that he ever signed. And I just made it under the wire, I guess.
You know, what is it that you feel you took away from working with Thom Bell? I mean, you talk about his own attributes. What about you? What did Preston Glass walk away with after working with Thom?
Well, of course, his genius can never be matched, but I learned a lot about arrangement. Of course, I think he's the greatest pop R&B music arranger of all time. I learned a lot about how to work with different artists, treat each artist as a different one, not impose your own sound on them, but you know, get into what they do and try and make the best record for them. I learned a lot of things. He taught me the importance of the business side of music and publishing and all that kind of stuff. But he taught me to just be yourself, you know. Much as I loved him, don't try and be him. Try and do your thing, because that'll serve you well. And I appreciate that advice.
Excellent. And I was reading something on your post where you talked about, you know, Thom was responsible for discovering the songwriters, George Merrill and Shannon Rubicam, who both wrote How Will I Know and I Want to Dance with Somebody Who Loves Me. And also what was interesting, you put that he died on the same day that the Whitney Houston biopic was released. So if you could just share what's so interesting about, you know, about that.
Yeah, it's interesting to me because there are a lot of things being said about Thom these days, especially since he passed just so recently. But I wanted to just try and put out there a couple things that maybe almost nobody knows. I mean, George and Shannon will tell you that Thom put them on the map. They were signed maybe a couple of years before my brother Alan and I were signed to Bellboy Music up in Seattle. In fact, when we moved up to Seattle, Jordan Shannon took over their little Scooby-Doo van and helped us to move into our apartment. So that's how close-knit the little Bellboy Music factory was. We had Bell and James, Thom had a couple other writers, Joe Erickson, Frankie Blue. Frankie Blue, for those of you who are big Thom Bell fans, you might know his name from the Fish That Saved Pittsburgh soundtrack. Frankie sang Moses.
Okay.
Vocals, a singer, and he sang the duet with Loretta Lynn. But so a lot of great songwriters there. And so I just wanted to put out there that even though George and Shannon didn't really have many cuts with Thom, I think they had some things with Phyllis Hyman. But after they left that stable, they went on to forge a phenomenal career, of course, as artists in their own right with Boy Meets Girl, Waiting for a Star to Fall. They had a big hit with that. And then How Will I Know and I Want to Dance with Somebody, that speaks for itself, both number one records.
Mm-hmm.
And both really dear friends of ours to this day.
Excellent, excellent. And what else is there that you can share about Thom Bell that you people may or may not know about him? Because also, are you working on a documentary around him as well? Because you sort of alluded to that there may possibly be a documentary coming out in March 2023.
Well, I'm not working on it, but there is a film being shot. I think the finishing touches are being put on a documentary for the Philly Sound with Gamble Huffenbill.
Oh, okay.
Thom plays a very prominent role in this documentary, being one of the Mighty Three. So, and it's some major directors and producers putting this on. I'm not sure where it's going to surface. It might be a next Netflix kind of a thing.
Okay.
So I was working in the studio just recently with Russell Tompkins Jr.
Yes.
And
I Statistics, by the way.
Yes, lead singer with that voice. Yeah. So I called Thom while Russell was working with me because he hadn't talked to him in a while. And they talked for a while. And Thom had said to Russell that, yes, I spoke highly of you in this documentary.
Oh, wow. What a tribute.
That was just this year. I think it was April of this year that we spoke to Thom.
Wow. And what else can you share about Thom Bell that, you know, like I said, you know, we may or may not know, but that just is part of his legacy.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people now are starting to see, oh, he not only wrote and arranged and produced, but he can sing too. There's a little video going on around on YouTube that shows Thom performing at a performance in, I think it was 1987. They did a salute to the songwriter. So he sat up on stage and sang almost all of his hits, but it's just him and the piano, and he sounded great.
Excellent.
And I remember that night being at that actual performance, and there was an executive from CBS there, which is now Sony. And he said, I'm going to sign Thom as an artist, right? And I think Thom, you know, Thom didn't want to be an artist. He knew where his bread would butter, but that's how talented he was. The man could actually sing. Of course, he sang background on a lot of his recordings anyway, some credit, some not credit. And speaking of that, another thing people might not know that Linda Creed actually confirmed it when I met her and wrote a song with her and Thom in the early 80s for the Stylistics. So I had a chance to work with Linda too. And Linda said, you know, a lot of these songs that Thom produced that he didn't write, he really wrote. I mean, he really had a hand in writing, whether it be the intro or rearranging the song. She said a song like Could It Be I'm Falling in Love for the Spinners. He really rearranged the way the Stills Brothers wrote that song. You know, it says on the label Maestro and Lyric, that was Melvin and Marvin Stills, the Stills Brothers. And Thom rearranged the song to make it the way he felt needed to be arranged. And then that famous intro, that's one of the best intros of all time, Thom wrote that. I mean, so a lot of people know he was a great songwriter, but part of what he did as an arranger, I know this from the six songs he did of mine working under his Bellboy Music. I would turn in a demo and then he'd say, okay, I'm going to use that for Phyllis Hyman. And then I'd, a couple months later, hear the way he did it, I'm like, wow. I'd hear the intro and go, well, you might as well take writer's credit on that, because that I didn't do that quite like that on the demo. I didn't have that kind of insight. So he was that kind of a genius.
Excellent. And if we may just touch a little bit on your career, Preston, so that people can get an idea who you are, if you don't mind. You know, being yourself a singer, songwriter, producer. Now I'm just going to read a little bit about what I picked up about you, because like I said, your list is quite long and illustrious as well. So you've worked with Kenny G, you produced his album Duotones, You produced George Benson on his 1988 LP, Twice the Love. You've also worked on Kenny G on his 1988 LP, Silhouette. You composed on Diana Ross's 1989 LP, Working Overtime. You produced Johnny Gill. And you performed on Tevin Campbell's 1993 album, I'm Ready. I mean, the list goes on and on. So just tell us a little bit more about you.
Well, as I mentioned at the onset of this interview, I'm really a songwriter. I mean, all these other things, musicianship, singing lead or background, arrangements, production, all that stuff came after my songwriting. I started writing songs at age 5.
Oh, wow.
Before I really knew what I was doing. It was a gift. It is a gift. And
yeah.
I remember, you know, that young being enthralled by looking at the little records, turning around the little 45s, remember them? And noticing names, not the names in the big print, but the little names in the parentheses. And I found out those were songwriters. And I'd kept seeing the name Thom Bell pop up on records that I liked. Other names, you know, like Holland Dozier Holland and,
yes.
Robinson and Carole King. I was like, well, I like all the songs that have their names on it. And I asked my dad, I said, who is that? He said, oh, that's the songwriters. And the way they make all the money. That's what he said. So I, at an early age, wanted to be a songwriter and really nothing else. All the other things came with wearing different hats and trying to make the project happen. So,
okay, brilliant. And in winding down, Preston, is there anything else that you would like to share about your, not just because Thom was your mentor, but also as a friend? What is there that you can share about this incredible man?
Well, he while he was a private individual, he was a loving individual, and he did care. He'd always ask, how's the family? And here's how much of a genius he was. I remember one time when I first started working with him, he was writing, scoring his strings on sheet music with his little pencil. But instead of looking down right at what he was doing, he was looking at me saying, how's your mom? But he was writing at the same time. I was like, how is he able to write? I mean, look at the paper. That's so much of a thing. But, you know, I had a little health scare about 5 years ago. I almost was not here myself. What I appreciate about Thom is he called me, checked on me periodically, encouraged me, told me to keep my hands on the piano and play. And so that showed it wasn't just a business relationship, but it was a friendship, a loving, almost like a father and son kind of thing.
Brilliant. Well, I want to say thank you to you for taking the time out. I have to say thank you to Andre Pittman for putting you on this platform. And, you know, thank you for what you've shared about Thom. And, you know, like I said, there's so many people coming out the woodwork who want to share or who are just looking at an inspiration that some people feel it's been lost, but I also feel it's about legacy. You know, he's left a really strong legacy, and what you all have been taken away from that, especially if he's mentored you or been in your sort of close proximity at some point in time, is this whole thing that's coming out about individuality, just allowing the artist, the person that you're working with, to be themselves and bringing it together. And I think that's also part of the uniqueness of who he was, because he's just allowing you to be who you are. And that's come out a couple of times in the interviews I've conducted about him.
Right. Well, thank you for shining a light on him, because, of course, I've always, like I mentioned earlier, wanted to emulate his talent and be around it. I was fortunate to be right there. But, you know, now, because of his passing, he's on the mind and hearts of a whole bunch of folks. And I appreciate you shining this light on him so people can really see what a great man he was.
Thank you. Thank you, Preston. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Wasn't true, and you passed them by.
Passed them.
Frames worn by Esther Austin on the show today are sponsored by Run It First.